It is Pastor Appreciation Service for you, and today is a day that you have selected in the month of October to honor your pastors. And so as a church, allow me to say thank you. You don't realize, and perhaps you do, that at times, pastoring is the loneliest position that you can be involved in. It's just difficult. And the reason being is because you're looked at a different level from you guys. Your perspective on leadership when it comes to the ministry is that we're perfect. And everything in our life is just hunky-dory and right where it should be, and nothing ever should be going wrong for us. And so you put us on this pedestal, and it makes life more difficult for us. And at times you put our family on that pedestal as well, and so it makes it difficult for our children to live up to the expectation that you have given them. And so ministry is difficult. And so not everybody stays in the ministry. If you have been looking at your social media, if you have been looking at the news, you'll find that there's a lot of our pastors who are stepping down from ministry. And so when you talk about pastors stepping down, we're not talking about pastors stepping down from small churches. We're talking about mega churches, pastors stepping down because of the routine being very stressful and very difficult. And the requirement and what the church requires from them and the demands that ministry has become so difficult over time, it almost rips away from the calling that's truly within them. And so pastorship's not easy. And so this morning, it was funny because when Pastor called me, my good friend, your pastor, called me and said, "Hey, listen, I really would love for you to come and preach this Sunday as Pastor Appreciation. I really don't want to preach my Pastor Appreciation." Exactly the same words that he said a minute ago. And I said, "Man, I would love to come. I would love to come and preach." And so I started going back to all the Pastor Appreciation messages that I've preached. I was like, "I can't do those because they are perhaps have been centered around the pastor in which I was preaching for." And then I thought, well, here's this one. I'm like, I already preached it a year ago here because he was gone. And I thought, God, why are you allowing me to preach this? It's not even Pastor Appreciation. But there was reason for that at that time. So I just begin to pray and say, okay, God, I got a few days. And some of you may know I had a very difficult funeral to officiate on Friday. Can I just be honest with you this morning before we get into the Word of God and just appreciate your pastor this morning? I have been doing ministry for a long time, youth ministry for 22 years, ever since I was 16. So it's now it's been 23 years. Ever since I was 16 years old, I've been doing ministry, youth ministry. And can I be honest with you? The hardest thing has been for me is to bury my kids. Not my physical kids, my biological kids, but the kids that was in my ministry. In these last 2 years, I've buried three that was under the age of 22. And can I be honest with you? That's difficult. I'm tired of burying the next generation. It's not the order of life. I mean, it's all appointed for all of us to die, but the truth is, it should be when we're in the upper ages of our life, right? And so I'm tired of burying the next generation. So as I begin to think about that funeral and the message that I wanted to give, and then also try to balance the message that I wanted to give today, God took me back to a message that I preached back in January at an event called The Encounter. And I want to share this because I want to give this to our leadership of our church today, but I want to also give it to my friends. And I want to be able to appreciate him, his family, and the church staff that's here today, because ultimately, I think about the church staff to be like Aaron and Hur. And maybe you know the story of the first battle that the children of Israel ever encountered. And it was against the Amalekites. And so we find that the story is where Moses is up on a hill and he's praying. As long as his hands are in the air, they're winning. But when his hands begin to fall, we find that the children of Israel struggles and are being defeated. Aaron and Hur begins to lift and uphold the hands of Moses, which would be considered your pastor. And they continued to win until victory was brought to the children of Israel. So what I want you to see today is that the staff that is encompassed around your pastor and family today is a staff that will uphold them. You can either continue to stand behind them and see victory, or you can stand behind them and step back a little bit and watch defeat happen. It's really important that as a church, as a body, and as a staff, that we support the pastor that God has given us. Amen? Hey, listen, it is, I would like for Brother Jeff and Sister Naomi and their family, if you would come and stand in front this morning, I would appreciate that. Will you give your pastor's hand as they come? Come on, keep your hands together. Let's keep clapping. There are 16 kids are not here yet, so we're waiting for all the 16 kids and counting. And counting, right? And kids. I don't know. But listen, I want to honor your pastors this morning. And we say pastors because the honest truth is the whole family is involved in the ministry that goes on right here at your church. And sometimes when dad's affected with the heavy load and demand of the church, it affects the whole family. And I can't tell you how many times, and I only know this because of my life, of being in the ministry, that when father has to be pulled away to do church demands, then the family is affected by that. And many events that perhaps the family hasn't had dad or mom there because they're taking care of church has probably been numerous. And so the demand on your pastor. And so the whole family is affected, and their whole family is part of the ministry. And this is your pastor's. If you give your pastors a hand, we'll do that. The value of friendship is important. To surround yourself with good people is important. To surround yourself with godly people is more important.
Amen.
I can't tell you this morning how precious your pastors are. I can't tell you enough of the passion they have for you and for this community. I can't stress to you enough the burden that they carry on their shoulders for you as individuals and you as a body. I can't stress that enough. I can't stress to you enough how many times late at night that they're awakened because of the struggles that you are facing. It's not their struggle, but it becomes their struggle because you're struggling.
Amen.
And their heart is breaking.
Amen.
These are good men and women.
Amen.
You have a great pastor. You have great pastors. Will you give them one more hand? Turn your Bibles with me this morning to 1 Kings chapter 19. I just want you to put a piece of paper there, if you don't mind. Just a marker, because we'll get to that in just a few minutes. But I want to speak to you this morning on the thought and to your leadership. So please understand, I'm speaking to your leadership, but I'm speaking to you as a body, as believers. Because I really believe that this message this morning will provoke each one of us to a greater understanding and urgency to protect the dreams, the vision, the passion, the calling that God has given to you and I. And if I can stress that enough, that you need to protect the gift that God has given you, you have to do that. There is an enemy of your soul. And his greatest desire and intent is to rob from you the very thing that God has given you. He doesn't want you to be blessed. He doesn't want you to be successful. He doesn't want you to gain the very thing that God has intended for you. He doesn't want that. Has there ever been a time of urgency for us to protect the very thing that God has given to us? It is now.
Amen.
It is now. It is now the time for us to protect the thing that God has given to us. If it be a dream, if it be a vision, if it be a calling, whatever it is that God has given you, you got to protect that. This morning I want to speak on this thought. Don't misuse your blessing. Don't misuse your blessing. There are those in my life and people in your life, if you don't matter, that you come in contact with. Listen to me this morning. There are those people that you come in contact with, the friends in which you surround yourself with, that makes your spirit leap with inside of you. That's the reason why it's so important that you surround yourself with godly men and women. It is so important that you surround yourself with people with like mind, because they make your spirit leap. Your dreams that were conceived by God jumps for joy when you're around them. I can't tell you how many times that just coming in contact with your pastor that my dream jumps. My vision that God has given me, the very thing that I've conceived, begins to turn within me and begins to awake again, because I'm just in the presence with somebody that's a dreamer like me. Someone that holds the same calling, someone that is passionate like me. The very thing that God has given me, my gift, she leaps for joy. My gift turns within me because of the people that I'm around.
Amen.
They're like-minded people. The visions that God has entrusted you and I with are awakened when those people speak.
Amen.
They're awakened. I don't know if you've been around those kind of people. Those people that when they speak, when they merely speak a word, it seems like the vision that once was asleep is now being awakened within you. Why? Because those people are like you. God is given to speak into your life. I really can't explain those kind of experiences to you. How your spirit leaps and how the very calling and gifts and maybe vision and dream and within you turns. I can't explain that. I don't know how it really looks like. The only thing I can explain, it was like those moments like Mary and Elizabeth had. You know, during the Christmas story, when you find that Mary, who is conceived with the baby Jesus, goes to Elizabeth, who is conceived with John the Baptist. And the Bible says that when they encountered each other, their babies leaped. There's something that was God-given to both of them that when they came in contact with, it leaped. There was something that was on the same level, and all of a sudden, that thing that was within them began to leap. You see, when these two ladies who were carrying something of God came in contact with each other, their God-giving babies began to leap inside of them. I love those moments. I don't know if you love those moments, but I love that those God-given conceived babies or ideals leap. I love to surround myself with leaders who have God-conceived ideals, God-conceived dreams, God can see visions, goals, callings, and who are willing to go through the full term and the labor pains to see their baby be birthed. Listen to me, I love being around those kind of people that are willing to go the full term to see the very thing that God has spoken to them, the very gift that God has given to them, to see that thing come about. No matter how much it's going to hurt, no matter how much difficulty they will face, they will go the full term to see that thing be birthed, to live, and to thrive.
Amen.
It's one thing to birth something, but it's another thing to nurture that, and to watch it live, and to watch it thrive. And so I love being around those type of people. The fact is that your baby makes my baby leap. It's weird, isn't it, right? I'm not pregnant this morning. But what I'm saying is the very God-conceived thing that's within me and the very God-conceived thing that's within you makes him leap when we come in contact with each other. You inspire me. You inspire me to continue to be patient with the process and never lose hope. That's what you do to me. Iron sharpens iron. You inspire each other. Brother Jeff, you inspire me. The very thing that God has conceived within you. And the very thing that God has conceived within me leaps when we come in contact with each other. Thank you. I know for some of you this morning, it's been a long time since you felt your baby. Listen to me this morning. I need you to hear this. For some of you this morning, it's been a long time since you felt your baby kid. It's been a while since your baby has kept you up all night with anticipation of his arrival. You haven't even heard the heartbeat lately. And for some of you, it seems as though your baby is overdue. And because of these feelings, you have begun to entertain thoughts that are not of God. because God perhaps has prolonged his visitation with you and the arrival of your baby. You've entertained thoughts that are not of God. You begin to question if God has really spoken to you. You have questioned the fact that God really conceived anything within me. Can God give me it, or did I just think of it? Or is it worth the hassle, the time, and the pain? Those thoughts are not of God. Listen to me. For those who haven't felt your baby kicking along the time, for some of you that haven't heard the heartbeat, I need you to listen to me. Those thoughts are not of God. Don't you believe one time that God hasn't given you a dream? Don't you believe one time that God hasn't called you for greatness? Don't you believe one time that God hasn't given you something to achieve? Don't you believe one time? It is worth the hassle, the time, and the pain. You have entertained the thought of giving up on the God-conceived baby that's within you. The truth is, God is not done with you. He's not done with the work within you. You have conceived something from God, and only you can birth it. Listen to that. Sometimes we're waiting for someone else to birth the thing that God has given us. Let someone else go through the labor. Let someone else have to deal with the pain. Let someone else deal with the struggle. Let me just show up at the end of the birthing process. Listen, there are times that, listen, I believe this. Only you can birth the thing that God has conceived within you. No one else can birth it. You have to birth it. You have to reach that dream. You have to become that calling. No one else can do it. No one else. That's the reason why God gave it to you. Listen, you didn't get that. That's the reason why God gave it to you. It's because it is yours. Quit looking for someone else to birth your baby. The problem this morning is your baby's been paralyzed. You see, you have allowed your baby to be affected by your frustration. Listen to me. You've allowed your dream, your vision, your calling to be paralyzed or stopped or put on pause for a moment because of your frustration, by your struggles, by your difficulties, by your naysayers. You allowed your naysayers to stop the process of what God is doing within you. You allowed your frustrations, you allowed the critics to stop you from pursuing the very thing that God has given you. Let me just be real. You've allowed fear. You allowed jealousy. You allowed the competitiveness. You allowed your bitterness. You allowed your hurt. And you have allowed your unforgiveness to stop you from seeing that baby come to full term. That's what's paralyzed your baby. That's the reason why you haven't felt it. Paul said that he didn't want us to be ignorant of the devices of Satan. He wanted us to be reminded and continue to be reminded of what he is trying to do and the devices to stop you and to stop that baby from ever coming to fruition. He doesn't want you to be in full-time ministry. He doesn't want you to have that calling. He doesn't want you to have that gift. He doesn't want you to fulfill the intended life in which God has intended for you. Why? Because it will affect his objective. It would mess up his plan. And so he would use every device and every tactic to stop you. And Paul says for us not to be ignorant. The reason why your baby is not leaping in the presence of certain people, and I need you to understand this morning, the reason why your baby is not leaping in the presence of certain people is because it has been paralyzed by the offense, by that individual. Some of you, when you get in the presence of other people, your baby doesn't leap anymore. It's because there's an offense there. Something that they said, something they have done. So your baby doesn't leap because of the offense. You see, unforgiveness will rip away all respect and value you have for that person. And so when you come in that presence of that person, your baby doesn't leap because you have no respect for him or her. Let me give you some cruel facts, if you don't mind, of the reality in which we live in. You see, being in a position of leadership, it doesn't matter if you're in the church world or the secular world. doesn't matter. There will be some people, excuse me, my tablet just messed up on me. It's been doing that lately. Here we are. I'm back. There are you guys like, man, I thought we were done already. Listen, my son didn't get on my laptop, so it's got full power. We're good to go. There are some people, someone who will take advantage of you. It doesn't matter where you're at. It doesn't matter if you're a shift manager at McDonald's or you work at as a manager somewhere in any business that's here in town at Seminole. It doesn't matter if you're a CEO. It doesn't matter if you're a foreman. It doesn't matter if you're a pastor, a youth pastor, children's pastor. It doesn't matter if you're in leadership of any kind. There's always someone that's going to take advantage of you. They're going to let you down. They're going to use you as a ladder to reach the position that they desire. Say things that are not true to destroy your reputation and attack your integrity. That's life. That's the cruelty of life. It's people, isn't it? And some of you, if I just ask you to raise your hand, if you've ever been affected by someone trying to climb the ladder, you probably all could raise your hand this morning that someone did something cruel to you just so they can get above you. It is in these moments that if you're not careful, that these issues of jealousy, hurt, and bitterness, and unforgiveness will take root and paralyze you and your God-conceived baby. So how do we keep this from happening? And so that's the important thing this morning. How do I stop this from happening? How can I continue to believe that the very thing that God has conceived in me will come to pass? How do I stop that from being paralyzed? Well, let me give you my title again. Don't misuse God's blessing. Because I think it's very important that sometimes in life we misuse the things that God has given us to attack the issues that we're facing in life. The things that are attacking your ministry, the things that are attacking your calling, your dream, your vision for your life and for your family, your marriage. God gives us the strength and we misuse it. So how do we stop this from happening? Don't misuse your blessing. I believe that you are here for a reason, a purpose this morning. Can I be honest with you? I think there's a reason why Pastor Jeff called me. I believe there's a reason why I'm preaching this message. I believe there's a reason why I'm standing here behind this pulpit. I believe there's a reason, an ordained reason. I believe that God ordained this moment for you and for me. Because hurt can destroy our lives. Listen, unforgiveness and bitterness can destroy our lives. I believe that God wants to visit us this morning. Listen, I believe that God wants to visit us every day of our lives. But I truly believe that we set aside a moment this morning to say, God, we want you to visit us. We want you to change our lives. We want you to speak to us. We want you to unparalyze our babies. Perform a miracle within our lives today, God. Refresh us, revive us as we walk out of this building, God, knowing that the very thing that you have given us is going to come about. I believe there are three things that will happen. I believe God will capture you this morning. I believe that God will overwhelm you, get your attention, rattle your cage for a moment. I think there's moments in our life we need God to overwhelm us. We need God to get our attention. We need Him to rattle our cage and shake us up and say, listen, it's not that bad. Listen, what He said, what she said, what He done, what she done, listen, it doesn't affect the overall picture. And He just overwhelms us. He captures us. And He gets our attention. It's a one-on-one moment with me and God, and He gets my attention, and He shakes me up a little bit. So what are you thinking? Why are you believing those things? And then the second thing I believe that God will do this morning is to confront you. Man, I don't like these moments. Can I just be honest with you? I hate it when God has to confront me. I love it when He captures me. I love it when He wraps His arms around me. I love it when He loves me. Man, those moments when God has to confront me about some things in my life, I'm not always happy about. But I believe that God's going to confront some of us this morning. I believe that God will bring to surface the issues that are affecting you. I believe that God is going to with you the areas of your life that need some attention.
Yes, God.
He's going to capture you, and then he's going to confront you this morning. And I believe the third thing is he's going to challenge you. I believe that God, when God challenges you, he'll give you the strength and the power to meet those challenges. There's never been a time in my life that God challenged me that he didn't give me the strength and the power and the courage to face that challenge.
Amen.
There's never been a time. And I believe this morning he's going to capture you, he's going to confront you, and then he's going to challenge you. And I believe that in the midst of all those three steps this morning, he's going to give you the strength, the power, and the courage to meet that challenge. I really believe that this morning. I believe that a visitation is truly a blessing from God. Have you ever had God step down and visit you? Speak to you? Minister to you? That's a blessing. Not everybody is having visitations from God. But when you set yourself aside and say, God, I need you to visit me. I need you to capture me, confront me, and challenge me. I believe that God blesses us.
Amen.
I want to take you just for a moment as you have slid a piece of paper and marked 1 Kings chapter 19. I want to take you there for a moment. And I want to look at the life of Elijah. And I just love Elijah. And a lot of my message at times surrounds Elijah. But I believe there's a moment in Elijah's life that God visits him. God captures him. He confronts him. And he challenges him. And God gives him the strength and he misuses it. God blesses him. He gives, listen, the greatest blessing that I need in life is just God strengthen me each day. Give me the strength to face my day. Give me the strength to live for you today, Lord. Give me your strength. And I want you to look at this story because there's three things that I believe that because of Elijah's misusing of the blessing, there's three things that continue to exist in his life. Listen to me. And I believe that if we misuse the strength and the blessing that God gives you and I, you think these three things are going to continue to exist. So for it not to exist is to not misuse God's blessing. Amen?
Amen.
So let's look at this. I want to read 1 Kings chapter 19. Let's start at verse 1. We've got to read a few scriptures if you don't mind. Verse 1. This is Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done. Also how he had executed all the prophets with the sword. And Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying, let the gods do to me and more also, if I do not make your life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time. And when he saw that, he arose and ran for his life and went to Beersheba, which also belongs to Judah, and left his servant there. Probably the greatest thing that you could, the worst thing that you could ever do in your life is to separate yourself from your friends. The worst thing that you could ever do is separate yourself from people who love you, who care about you. And that's what happens here. He left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down underneath a broom tree. And he prayed that he might die and said, it is enough. Now, Lord, take my life, for I am no better than my father's. Then as he lay and slept underneath the broom tree, suddenly an angel in a visitation from God touched him and said to him, arise and eat. And then he looked, and there by his head was a cake baked on coals and a jar of water. So he ate and drank and laid down again. And the angel of the Lord, another visitation, came back the second time and touched him and said, arise and eat, because the journey is too great for you. So he arose and he ate and he drank, and he went in the strength of that food 40 days and 40 nights as far as Horeb, the mountain of God. Listen to this verse again. Verse 8. He arose and he ate and drank and he went in the strength of that food 40 days and 40 nights. And there he went into a cave and spent the night in that place. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him. And he said to him, What are you doing here? Here's a third visitation. And he said to him, what are you doing here, Elijah? And so he said, I have been very zealous for the Lord God of hosts, for the children of Israel, for children of Israel have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with a sword. I alone am left, and they seek to take my life. Listen to verse 10 in the frustration in the voice of Elijah. He said to God, I have been very jealous for you, God of hosts, for the children of Israel have forsaken your servant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with a sword. But I alone am left. Yeah. And they seek to take my life as well.
Yeah.
Verse 11. And then he said, go out and stand. God says to him, go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind tore into the mountains and broke the rocks into pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a still, small voice. So it was, when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and stood and went out and stood in the entrance of the cave. And suddenly a voice, another visitation came to him and said, what are you doing here, Elijah? And he said, I have been very zealous. Listen to the voice again of Elijah, the frustration. I have been very zealous for the Lord God of hosts, because the children of Israel have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. And I alone am left, and they seek my life to take it. Then the Lord said to him, go return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. And when you have arrived, anoint Hazael as king over Syria. And his challenge continues on. Would you just bow your heads in a word of prayer? Father, we thank you so much for your love, your mercy, and your grace. And this morning, God, as you, I believe that you're about to visit us, capture us, confront us, and challenge us, Father. And I pray, God, that in that moment that you begin to bring me strength and courage and power within us to meet that challenge, Father. Let us not misuse it. Let us not misuse that blessing. Let's not misuse that moment that we have with you, God, that you confront us and you bring things to surface, God. Let us take that moment and let us have our lives changed by your power, God. God, let us never misuse the things that you give us, Father. God, we love you and we thank you. We give you glory in Jesus' name. We say amen and amen. I want to look at the story just for a few minutes because I need you to understand what's happening. We find that Elijah is underneath the broom tree. We find that he is very frustrated. We find that the baby that was once within him, that calling, that calling of a prophet, that very calling of a minister of God, that very dream, the very vision, the very voice of God is no longer alive within him. He is pleading with God to have his life taken from him. He no longer wants to be a part of the process of what God has been doing within him. He doesn't no longer want to see the things come to fruition that he has so much prayed for and that God has so much seen or showed him. He doesn't want to be a part of that anymore. And the Bible says that God visits him. God visits him as an angel and he gives him bread and water to eat. Gives him strength. Yeah. And as he begins to get his belly full, just like all of us, we take a good nap and he lays down again. The Bible says that God visits him again. He wakes him up and he says, listen, the journey is too great. The battle is too great. You got to have strength. You got to take advantage of this visitation. You got to take advantage of this blessing. You cannot misuse this. And so the Bible says that he gets up and he eats and he drinks again. And then here's the crazy thing. Because the Bible says he takes that food and that strength that God has given him, that blessing, and he takes it, and he goes 40 days and 40 nights, and he finds himself in a cave. And I just gotta believe this morning that is not where God wanted him to be. That's not why God gave him the strength. That's not why God gave him water. That's not why God woke him up two times to make sure that he ate. And the reason why I say that is because twice God says, what are you doing here, Elijah? As though that the physical place was not where God wanted him to be. Yes. That's not why God gave him the strength.
Right.
He had misused the strength that God had given him. He had misused his visitation. And he went 40 days and 40 nights to a place he was not supposed to be.
Amen.
Amen.
Listen to me. Elijah had a visitation with God. God strengthened his body. He strengthened his dream. He strengthened his vision. And he misused it. He found himself alone in a cave. Listen, I just believe that we can misuse the visitation this morning. When God captures you, confronts you, and challenges you, I believe that we can misuse that, and we got to be very careful. There's three things that I believe that if we're not careful, that if we misuse our blessing, these three things will exist in our life. Because listen, Elijah was in a cave. He was not where God wanted him to be. Here's the three things. One, look at the time, I'll move very quickly. One, it causes you to be out of position to deal with your problems. Now, let me go back to the beginning of the story. Elijah's problem was a woman. It was Jezebel. Now, husbands, don't be looking at your wives, all right? Like, she's not your problem, all right? Here's what I'm saying. Elijah's problem was a woman who wanted his life. He got scared and he ran for it. He ran away from his problem and still dealing with it. He finds himself underneath a broom tree, and the Bible says that God gives him the strength not to go to a cave, not to spend 40 days and 40 nights on a journey. His journey was the battle with Jezebel. That was his problem. That was his issue. And now he's in a cave and he's nowhere in position to do battle with Jezebel. Listen to me. When you misuse your strength, you will be out of position to deal with your problem. You will be out of position to deal with your issue. The very thing that's causing your baby no longer to leap. Causing your dream to not come to fruition. The calling that's on your life, the anointing on your life to not be where it needs to be. It's because you're out of position to deal with the problem. And some of us, it's so easy for us to run from our problems than deal with it. But can I be honest with you? God has given you strength and blessing to deal with your problems, not run from them. Listen to me. You've ran way too long. There's family issues that you have ran away from too long. There's friendship issues that you have ran away from too long. And God has given you the strength, the ability to forgive, the ability to get rid of the bitterness.
Amen.
And the unforgiveness that's within your life, in your heart. But for some of us, it's easier for us to turn around and run than it is to confront them. Listen, you're not understanding. It was easy for Elijah to run from Jezebel than it was for him to confront Jezebel.
Amen.
And for some of you, it's the same thing. You don't like confrontation. Is there anybody in the room that really likes confrontation? I love confrontation. Bring it on, baby. No. None of us in this room really enjoys confrontation. None of us. But there are times in our life where we must confront the issue. We must deal with it. If not, we'll misuse the strength, the visitation. You've been crying out, God help me. And when God strengthens you, you run instead of deal with it. It's a cycle. It happens all the time in the lives of God's people. The second thing is this. If you misuse God's blessing, it causes the problem to exist, to continue to exist. Listen, you can stick your head in the dirt and never think about that problem again, but it still exists. You can go home and get in your bedroom, lock your door, climb in your bed, pull the covers over your head, and put the pillow over your ears. Guess what? The problem still exists. You can run as long as you want to. As far as you want to. You can try to do anything that you want to, but the problem still exists. Your addiction is still there.
Amen.
You didn't get it. The very thing that you're struggling with, God is, wants to give you strength to break that. Not to run away from it, not to face it. I got a problem. Brother Jeff, I got a problem. God, I got a problem. This is my problem. I'm addicted. And God says, I want to give you the strength to break it. I'm going to give you the courage to admit it and break it. But instead, we want to run from it. And your problems still exist. You're not understanding me. Elijah ran to a cave 40 days and 40 nights. He took the strength, he misused it, went to a cave, and guess what? Jezebel was still alive. Jezebel still wanted his life. There was still a mark on him. He was a dead man. The problem still existed. And when you misuse the blessing that God has given you, the problem still exists. You can cover up all you want. Yeah. You can make excuses for it all you want. Yeah. You can paint it another color. It's still there. You can call it something else. But it's still there.
Yes.
It's still there. And can I be honest with you this morning? The problems that's unattended to, this is going to affect your life.
Amen.
How do I know that? You ready for this? I have walked into a building before with people that might have an issue with me, and they have walked the other direction. And I'm like, I have no problem. Like, never mind. He walked the other way. Listen, I've been in grocery stores with people that might have an issue with me. And I really don't have an issue with that person. And guess what? That person walks away from me. They'll try everything to get out of the same aisle that I'm in. Oh, little brother Jerry. He doesn't see me. You know? Skinny me, right? He can't see me. Close my eyes. If I don't see him, he don't see me. Don't move, right? But the problem still exists. And it affects your whole life. Why? Because you plan your whole day around your problem.
Yes.
You plan your vacation around your problem. You plan anything and everything around your problem. Just deal with your problem. Get your problem out of your life.
Amen.
And live life. Amen?
Amen.
Number three. I just thought of something, but I can't say it. Number three. I rebuke that thought in the name of Jesus. Number three, misused blessings will cause your baby to be paralyzed. That's just the truth. Listen, every one of you, I need you to look up this for a moment and I'll be done. It is 12:04 and it's Pastor Appreciation and we have dinner. And I know that some of you have responsibilities to take care of before we get over there or while we're there. So let me close up real quickly. I need everybody to look up at me. I love your pastors to death. They mean the world to me. I have a few friends in ministry, close friends that I wouldn't want to do ministries without. And Pastor Jeff is one of those. He means that much to me. Out of all my friends, I had two friends call me this week and say, how you doing? Out of my ministerial friends, how you doing? I know that you're dealing with this death with a student that wasn't in your youth ministry. How you doing? I had, out of those two friends, both of their families showed up to visit the funeral and just to support me. Brother Jeff was there. This other family was there. I don't want to do ministry without them. I mean the world to me. But I also know, from leadership to those who sit on the pew, that if we misuse the visitations that we have with God, and the moments that He strengthens us and gives us that bread and that water to face our issues, if we misuse that, and we run from our problems instead of face our problems, our life will be affected. And the ministry and the anointing and the calling is on all of us.
will not be fulfilled. It won't. It'll be hindered. It'll be delayed. Can I use the word delayed? Because when we look at Elijah, his ministry was delayed, and all of a sudden he picks it back up because God shakes him up a little bit and says, listen, you're not supposed to be here. Go do what I've called you to. And so some of us are like on a delayed moment. You're not doing what God's called you to do because you're, that dream, that vision, that baby that we're relating it to is paralyzed within you. Because you've misused the very thing that God intended for that baby to be unparalyzed, for you to have strength and courage and motivation and the ability to continue on. You've misused that. You've misused it. And if I can say anything this morning to help you is don't misuse your blessing. Don't miss this moment when God captures you. He confronts you. And he challenges you. Because I think in those moments is when God gives us the strength. Amen? Amen. Can you give the Lord a hand clap of praise this morning?